5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the LMC Cast. We're back once again for your monthly roundup. And with me today, we have some very special guests. We have the Random Genius.
Hello there.
We have ShadowFox.
Ahoy, hoy.
We have Nabal.
Good evening.
And we also have the big boss man himself, Kev.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to the fourth Radio Redux show in a row.
Yay!
Except it's not. Sorry.
Well,
yay!
It could be.
Depends on future rebranding, maybe. But yes,
it's a last minute Radio Redux.
And then there's also me, Earthheart, again. And
yay!
Today, today we're playing a game that we have oddly enough never played on any of these recordings yet, despite the fact that most of us have played it quite a few times, and that is Disney's Villainous. If you don't know what Disney's Villainous is, you play as a Disney villain trying to enact basically what they're trying to do, the evil deeds they're trying to do in their movie, which makes the game quite interesting because everyone has different objectives. And we'll go through those in a moment. But the way you stop your opponents is by basically drawing from their hero deck, or the fate deck, as it's called, and playing heroes to their realm to stop them while you carry out your dastardly plans. So we'll do round robin. I'll start. I am playing as Gaston. Gaston can do anything he wants, but only after he's overcome obstacles. So my objective is to get rid of the 8 obstacles that are on my board. Let's go around clockwise. Mr. Kevin.
Oh, don't you disrespect me, little man. Don't you derogate or deride. You're in my world now, not your world. And I've got friends on the other side because I am playing as Dr. Facilier. My goal is I want to rule New Orleans, funnily enough. To do that, I will need to... Well, Dr. Facilier's got like an extra mechanic... that we will get to, but I effectively need to have the talisman with the blood in that turns Prince Naveen into a frog. I need control of that, and I also need to be able to play the cards, rule New Orleans or something like that, in a very specific way, and if I do those two things, I will win.
Yes, so he can win kind of out of the blue. All of the decks generally have some kind of unique mechanic to them. Dr. Facilier's one is... definitely one of the...
I have to have the card, play the card, discard the card, and then use a card to bring that card back. It's
an interesting one.
It's an interesting one. But my friends from the other side will help me.
Mr. Genius.
Hey, is it hot in here or is it just me? I think you know it's just me, because I am playing Hades from Hercules. And my objective is to get 3 Titan cards, which are in my deck, and put them over to Mount Olympus, which is one of the positions on my player's board. I have the underworld, where Titans appear, then they go to Thebes, then the gardens, then to Mount Olympus. As soon as I get 3 Titans at Mount Olympus, I win.
Yes, as anyone
well,
has...
As soon as I start my turn...
Yes, because people can interfere with that. But yes, we all have a board with 4 locations on, and each turn we have to move to one of those locations. We'll explain that as we go along. Nibal.
I am playing as Cruella de Vil, and my objective, I have to collect various puppy tiles and get 99 puppies worth of them. I don't have as many allies as my fellow villains have, but hopefully the 2 idiots will get the puppies for me.
Yes, I think you only have the 2 allies.
I only have the 2 allies.
Yeah, which makes it quite interesting. And ShadowFox, who is the only newcomer playing today.
The one who has no idea what he's doing, but I picked a classic one. On the seas, hunting for that green tunic-wearing, sword-wielding twink. But it's not Ganon, it's Captain Hook.
Captain Hook is the sword-wielding twink.
Yes, Captain Hook's objective is, quite literally, kill Peter Pan on the Jolly Roger.
Yeah, gotta lure him in and eventually kill him, because he's all the way over at his base. Everyone is free. Gotta bring him in.
So the way the game works is we all take it in turns, and the first thing you have to do on your turn is move to a location that is not the same location as where you are currently. So everyone starts on the far left location. Once a turn, you have to move to another location. It doesn't have to be adjacent. And then you can perform all of the actions that are on that point. So there's generally 4 actions per point. Some people have less, some people have more. But we'll explain what we're doing as we go along. In order to give ShadowFox the most time to see what other people are doing, I suggest I go first and we go clockwise round. That sound good?
Yes.
Okay with that.
Okie dokie then. So, actually, before we do that, I have to give people their starting power. So because I'm starting, I don't get anything. Kev, you start with 1 power.
Okay.
Mr. Genius and Nabal, you start with 2 power.
Thank you kindly.
Yes, thank
and
you.
Captain Hook, John, you start with 3.
He is the most powerful of all of these people.
He doesn't start with 3, he starts with Smee.
He starts with Smee.
Oh, he doesn't start with Smee because Smee's in his deck.
But he has Smee power.
Oh, dear. Okay, so I'm going to take my first turn, and I'm going to move to the woods. This allows me to do four actions. One of those actions is to discard cards. I do not want to discard any of my cards. So, yeah, let's not do that. I can gain two power because of the number two block on there. I can play a card, which, you know, I don't actually have enough power to play any cards, so I can't play any cards. But I can fate someone. And, you know what? I think I'm going to start with Mr. Genius just because, you know, got to start with someone. So when will you fate someone?
What have I ever done to you?
Because he knows I'm next and he fears me doing something.
Slightly. Also, Kingdom Hearts. So when you fate someone, you draw the top two cards of their fate deck, whoever you choose to fate. Oh, actually, there's no fate taken. Because you're not allowed to fate someone twice in a row. Is the main thing.
Hang on a second. I'd like to introduce you to... Oh, that dice doesn't move. Hang on.
It does now. It just had to load all the different colours on it.
This is the fate die. You have been fated that way.
So,
that's weird that's missing, though.
Yeah. So let's flip over these two. And we have... I can choose to have Hera, which is... I can't see because everyone's hands over it. When Hera is played or moved, you may choose a Titan at her location. That Titan is now trapped. Trapped Titans can't move, basically. Or an item which I have to equip to a hero. I have to pick one or the other. So I'm going to pick the hero. And
I really don't want to pick the item. The item's really useful. It could definitely help boost whatever heroes you've got on play at the minute.
And I'm going to place Hera... Let's place Hera in Mount Olympus for the moment.
Now, with the hero card being placed down, that actually covers up two of the options that Random Genius could have used if they were to move to Mount Olympus. It's covered the two top ones. There's now only two items that they could do if they have to go to Mount Olympus at any given point.
Yes. And the way you get rid of heroes is by getting allies or playing cards that destroy heroes, basically.
So if you want to kill the Queen of the Gods, you're going to need to have someone... Is it equal to?
Equal to or more.
And she's got four power or four
which
strength.
I think Hades isn't too bad. Bear in mind, you can, in theory, play the Titans to kill them, but the problem with the Titans is they have to start in Mount Olympus and make their way up there. And you kind of don't want to do that. But Hades has plenty of other allies. You can gang up allies as well. So if you want to sick two allies on a single one, you can do that. That is the end of my turn because, I can't really do anything else. So, Dr. Facilier.
Yes, yes. So I have my sort of home base is the Voodoo Emporium. Then there's the parade, which... is the parade at the end of the entire film. Tiana's place, which is a dream sequence, and the bayou, which is the bayou. I am going to move to the bayou, actually. And I'm going to do that. That's my fourth place, but it will get me free power.
Yeah, everyone has a free power spot except Gaston. Gaston needs a lot of power as well, which is kind of annoying.
The other ones there are... Which ones are these? Hang
on. You've got two player cards and move an ally.
Yes. So I could play two cards, technically, if I wanted to. Let me actually have a look at my cards.
Now, cards do have a power cost to them, which is the number in the top left corner. Obviously, none of you guys can see this. This is more for our benefit. But yes, so you can only play cards if you have enough power to play them, which is why I couldn't play any cards, because I didn't have enough power.
I have the ability to do that. So what I will do is I will immediately call upon for the cost of no power.
Oh,
my friends on the other side, which gains me two power. So it takes me up to six already. And then I have to put friends on the other side into the fortune pile, which is this one here. So this is like the extra thing that I need to drag Rule New Orleans out of at some point in the game. Technically, that's kind of important, having one of those cards, but having it right at the start of the game doesn't seem much point. I will then use the two power I've just gained, so I'll take down to four. And my other player card ability to play Shadow Spirits, which is an ally card, which I will place at the bottom of the bayou. So I have literally called upon my friends from the other side. And they have a strength of 3. They are an ally. So, and then I will do a whole heap of nothing else, because there's no point in me moving in the ones I've just placed down.
And at the end of your turn, you draw back up to 4 cards.
I do indeed. So I'll actually need to draw 2 in this instance. And then I hand you over to the... Oh, hello.
Well, before we start, you had 6 power, didn't you?
For a briefest of seconds, yes.
I play the condition card Ruthless. If another player has 6 or more power at any point, you may play Ruthless. You can play an ally or Titan from your hand for free.
All right, feel free.
And so I summon the Titan Argus. Argus can be played in the underworld. When Argus is mooned, you gain 1 power, and Argus has a total strength of 4.
So, yeah, he has 1 Titan on the board already, but we could move Hera over to him, if we have the ability to lock him up. However, Hades, it is now your turn. You've got 2 cards left.
We draw up at the end of the turn, correct?
Always draw up at the end, yes.
Let's see, what do I want to do? Well, I think I'm going to go over to Thebes, which gives me the opportunity to discard a card, or play a card, or gain 1 power, or fate someone.
Well, you can do all of the actions on the spot.
Yeah, sorry, I meant and.
You don't have to, but you know, why wouldn't you gain 1 power?
Yes, indeed. So I immediately gain a power, so my power's now at 3. I can choose to play a card, which I will...
Hard thinking.
Yes.
There are many choices to be had.
Many choices.
Yeah, I'm more worried about the bottom left choice he has to make.
I'm going to play 3 power, and I'm going to summon an item called the Chariot. And I'm going to put it in the gardens.
Interesting.
A Chariot is, if I start my turn in the same location as the Chariot, after I've performed all my actions, I can then move Hades and the Chariot to any other location and perform 1 available action for free. I cannot use the Chariot to perform fate actions.
Ah, okay.
So if I want to get a bit more extra power, I can zip over to another location and get some extra power if I should choose to. So it just adds a little bit of extra movement option for myself. And I'm not discarding a card, but there is a fate. And turnabout is fair play, Gaston.
Yeah, fair enough.
So, your 2 are, I've never seen so many books, replace 1 obstacle, or massaging my feet, replace 2 obstacles.
Unfortunately, all my obstacles are already on the field, so both of those are useless.
Cannot be played if there are no removed obstacles, yeah.
Yeah. Actually, it's quite good that these cards have tooltips on them, so.
Mm.
But so, thankfully, that fate hasn't done me too much damage, but they will get recycled back into the deck at some point, so. Oh, yes, I get the fate dice now.
Get the fate. The die of fate.
So you have performed 3 actions. Is that the end of your turn?
That's the end of my turn.
Nabal.
Right. I will move Cruella from the Radcliffe house over to the countryside. And my first thing I'm going to do for that is I'm going to get power.
You've gone for the free power location, so.
Yep. Immediately. Let's see, what else would I like to do? I would like to... You know, I'd like to play a bit sort of Horace, you fucking alien!
I don't remember that quote.
I don't think that was in the original film.
I think it might have been the Broadway.
Oh, that was very much off-Broadway, that version.
So Horace has an ability, but to use that ability, Cruella has to be on one of the 2 spaces that have an activate ability on it.
Yeah, which is fine. I shall prep for later, and we shall find out whether it bears any fruits.
Anything else you'd like to do? You can play another card,
I don't...
and you can move an ally if you really want to.
That devil woman.
Ooh.
I will... Oh, I guess a hero card, actually, so my bad.
Yeah, you don't have any heroes, so...
Never mind. I shall leave it as it is.
Okie dokie, draw back up, and then it is Captain Hook's turn.
Right, well, let's see if I learn enough from you foregoing. So I will sail.
So one Captain thing to note is that Captain Hook can't go to the Hangman's Tree at the moment because it's locked.
It is locked, but I will still sail over to Skull's Rock.
Okie dokie. So you have 4 actions.
Call a home. 4 actions.
So the Hangman's Tree is where the Lost Boys reside, right? So he has to discover its location before he
can go.
There is a map card, the Neverland map. Once I get that, I can play it.
Yep. So his first half of his job is just trying to find that card.
Yeah, got to find that Peter Pan.
So you've gained one power. You can play a card. You can discard as many cards as you like. And you can also fate someone.
Yeah. Well, I have enough power. Call in an ally. So, you know what? Pirate Brute. He's going to go get some protection money from the Mermaid Lagoon.
So Pirate Brute has a power of 4, but he doesn't do anything else.
He's a brute. He's a strong man. About it. And then fate. There are two people here who also haven't been fated, so we'll go with Nabal. Why not?
Oh, joy.
I mean, you've got to get the ball rolling eventually.
True.
I don't think you can get any better than Josh's pick, though.
No, yeah.
Well, so at the moment.
Captain Hero. When Captain is played, you may move an ally from his location to an adjacent location. Or Twilight Bark. Choose and play a hero from Cruella de Vil's Fate's discard pile. Well, there doesn't have a fate discard pile.
You
pass.
Probably want to play Captain.
Play Captain.
Choose which place to place him.
Countryside, the house. You know what? At the farm. Captain at the farm. Seems like the place where he'd probably be.
Okie dokie then. Captain has a power of 3. So while Horace can take him, it does mean Horace gets taken out of the field.
Horace can take this horse.
He could take a whole horse in a fight, right?
A whole horse in a fight.
Yeah, in a fight.
At the very least, it'll be a draw, everybody.
Okay, would you like to discard any cards?
No, and then I just draw back up.
Back up to 4. So this is the thing. You do want to cycle through your deck as quick as possible to get that map.
To find that, yeah.
Yeah, so you may want to consider discarding stuff if you have anything you think this is not immediately useful. But that's for later.
Yes. No, yeah, next turn. Yeah, okay. I can at least play some stuff out here. Right.
Yeah. Let's go for another round. It's back to Gaston. And I think Gaston will go to the tavern, which gains me another 2 power, which means I can finally play a card. And I'm going to play Come Into the Light. I can remove up to 2 obstacles from the same location. And I believe I can pick the location. Yeah, they don't have to be from where I am. But I'm still going to remove them from... I'm going to remove him from Belle's house.
That's concerning from the character level. That
just a little bit.
What's Gaston's first move? Remove all the obstacles from Belle's house.
And then I have an activate action, which I can't do because I don't have any cards that use it. And I have a vanquish action, which I can't do because I don't have any allies. But there's also no heroes in my realm, so that's the end of my turn.
For want of trying.
This is true. So I'm just going to draw back up, and that is the end of my turn.
So before we go any further, I must remind people that Gaston is already a quarter of the way to his goal.
Yes, because he has removed all obstacles from Belle's house.
He would probably call it quits here if he could.
Yes.
So that is the end of my turn, Dr. Facilier.
Right. Anyway, stuff is going to occur. I will move from the bayou to the parade, where I will get myself a very fancy mask, if you remember the film. But I will also get 2 power, like so. I do have the ability to discard cards. It is cards, isn't it? I can do multiple for the same. Discard cards.
Yes, you can do as many as you like.
And I can move an ally. Now, I'm not going to discard cards. What I am going to do is play a card, though, and... Would you, Adam and Eve it? What came out?
Oh, no.
Rule your leads!
Oh!
The 3 power! You know, the thing that's absolutely vital. It is immediately put into the fortune pile, which for the benefit of you guys is supposed to be face up. Yes. But that's kind of a massive thing for Dr. Facilier. Well, Dr. the 2 Facilier... key cards. Now in play.
Yeah, Dr. Facilier is another one who wants to go through his deck quickly to get the cards he needs.
Indeed.
He's got a little bit of work to do after that, but once that's happened...
there's a little bit of work to do, but not really that much, depending upon... Oh, yeah, because there's like conditions on... Most of my stuff has conditions on it.
Mm. Yeah, but... so for instance, I believe you can't even play the mask to your side of the field. You have to play it on a hero.
You have to, yeah,
and beat the hero.
It has to be, it has to belong to a hero, then you have to get it off the hero or physically move them down. It's complicated. Anyway, but having Rule New Orleans immediately out into that fortune pile, big for me. Really big. I don't get to fate anybody. I rather suspect I'll be fated very soon. That is the end of my turn. So,
you don't want to move your ally?
No, I don't see a point in moving the ally. I moved the ally there for a reason.
Yeah, no, that's fair.
Let me just get myself another card. Oh, hello.
He's got a talisman, hasn't he?
No, I haven't. I kind of forgot. I forgot what this card existed. Okay.
Hades.
Right, let's get some card combos up, shall we? So I'm moving over to the gardens, which means I can do any of these actions. Discard a card, play a card, gain 3 power. I gain 3 power immediately.
I should point out you can also do them in any order.
In any order, indeed, yes. I am then going to spend 3 power, summon Nessus, an ally, in Mount Olympus. Allies can be placed anywhere. Titans can only be placed in the underworld. If Nessus is used to defeat a hero with a strength of 3 or less, you gain 2 power. He has a strength of 4. So, I am not wanting to discard a card. I do not wish to play another card. But
you don't have any power, so it's going to be difficult to do so.
True. Well, mind you, I do have 0 power cards, so...
Yeah, that's true.
So, because I'm on the same place as my chariot, I'm going to move to the underworld.
Hey.
Which means I can perform any one action in the underworld for free, and that is going to be a vanquish action. So I am going to use Nessus to vanquish Hera. They are both the same power type, so they are both discarded.
Hera is dead.
Nessus was that centaur-like creature that Hercules saved Meg from, which was the bit of a setup at the beginning of the film. Mm-hmm. By the way, yes. Who's interested?
I believe it is based on mythology, so.
Mm-hmm. I would imagine so.
Unfortunately, Hera was a bit too powerful, so Nessus doesn't gain extra. Hades doesn't gain extra power from Nessus, but could be worse.
Could have been my Titan.
Mm. This is true.
And that is the end of my turn.
Okay, you moved your chariot. That's an item, yes?
That is an item, yes.
Okay, excellent. I activate Cruel. During this turn, if another player moves an ally or an item, I may play Cruel. Choose one puppy token from the supply and add it to a specific location. I pick this one and I shall add it to, you know, the house. And it is a 22.
So you have to get tokens that add up to 101 or over, I take
99.
It?
99.
And they're all multiples of 11, I should point out.
I think it's only 11 and 22.
I think they're only 11 and 22, but...
Anyway...
All right, so I'm going to start off by... Let's move to Hell Hall for now. First things first, I'm going to gain a power as one of my actions.
So Hell Hall actually has 5 things to do.
That's a bonus action. Yeah.
Mm.
I am going to... That move item or ally, that affects any of these tiles, or is it just that tile?
No, it's move any ally or item you control.
Mm.
So you can move Horus.
Horace, time to get to me.
Go back home, Horace. Get away from that horse, Horace. He'll take you out.
And now you can activate Horace.
I could do that, but first things first, I'm also going to play a card.
Oh.
And I play the Fireplace Poker.
Oh, dear.
Ooh.
Costs me 1 point, and it gives, in this case, Horace an extra point, so he now has a strength of 4. So, 4. And when the ally will be discarded, this item is discarded instead.
So this allows Horus to attack someone, win, and stay on the field.
Yeah, which is an excellent move. And I have 2 other options left. I can discard or I can activate a card at this point. You know what? I'm going to activate Horus and time to take the puppies.
Charge so I Horus put them up. On Cruella is normally where like objectives go.
It says on this, it was stick them down below.
Yeah, it's more just so everyone can see them.
Stick them in a visible area where we can.
Yeah. Just stick on.
Can you please hide these puppies visually?
By the way, Nabal, have you played 4 actions this turn?
I have, yes, actually.
Then I play Beautiful as Me. If another player during their turn plays 4 or more actions, I can remove an obstacle token.
Oof.
One goes from Beast Castle, just because I'm so handsome. And please continue. Would you like to discard anything?
I don't want to discard anything. I'm going to be good. I'll be good with that. And then my turn, I shall draw two.
Okie dokie then.
There you are.
Captain Hook.
Captain Hook. Oh, what's he going to do? He's going to continue his path down to the Mermaid Lagoon. Why can't I? There we go.
So I should point out, you can move to any location. You don't just have to go adjacent.
I know, but yep. This allows me to first off get 3 power.
This is true.
Which is a nice chunk. Which now allows me to bring out the MVP, Smee!
Smee!
Who gets a bonus 2 strength if he's at the Jolly Roger. So guess where he is at? Gotta leave someone you can trust in charge of the boat.
You've stuck him in Long Tom, haven't you?
Yeah. At which point, so that takes 2 power. I can also place 2 cards on this turn, so...
You can play another card if you want to.
I'm going to give an item to Smee. I'm going to make sure he's armed with a cutlass.
Oh, that's Smee. That's...
Smee is never just
sailed it. If you give this to Smee, it's basically worthless.
Yeah. But yeah, it gives him an extra 2 strength. So Smee is at 6 strength. He's stronger than the pirate brute.
Oh, but only in very situational circumstances.
Yes.
Only when he's on the Jolly Roger. Right. And then your only that other thing another... is you can move an ally if you
wish
to.
Move an ally. I'm happy with them where they are. So I will draw. I can draw back up. So
you can draw 2 this time.
Cool. And that I shall do.
On to the walking insult to the Me Too movement.
Well, I was going to say, we've done 2 rounds now. Do we want to do a round of someone?
Well, 30 odd minutes, and I say yeah.
Yeah. Any volunteers for first dibs?
I can get myself out of the way, more or less. So it's been not a terribly, terribly... well, there's been one big thing. But it's been doing some more catch-up and going back to some old stuff. So as far as watching things, I'm almost done with Vger at last. It's... So we're missing our regular Vger. So
where are you up to? Where are you up to on?
I'm about to start, I believe it's the finale of the penultimate season, which is a two-parter, I think. So I'm basically on the last season.
Uh-huh.
Which it's been good. Just enjoying the different kind of scenario that it's different. It's just different to everything else, going through an entirely unexplored area and committing as few war crimes as possible. But, you know, you get one as a treat every so often. Try and not release a biogenic plague somewhere.
But it's certainly preferable.
Going this far, because again, it's like me seeing Picard and seeing Seven of Nine on that and going, okay, well, how does she get from Borg drone to this? And it's like, okay, she's actually fairly human now, still running efficiency protocols, but at least not, she's more human. I get it now. But yeah, it's like, it's nice that they've been able to be able to, when you do Star Trek, sure, you have the entire universe to play with, but you're always kind of in a safe spot, giving them the chance to do some more wildly drastic things. And even then, you've got a holodeck, so you can go to Ireland for a bit and program yourself a perfect Irish bar and to become your hottie for the week.
Oh, that one.
Yeah.
Remove the beard. No, I don't like that. But put back, a couple of days worth of growth.
Three days of stubble.
That's more like. Oh, and also delete the wife.
Delete the wife.
Delete the wife.
Such a great line. So yeah, hopefully by the time next week, I will have run out of Star Trek. Well, next week, next month.
Next week is technically next month if you...
It is, actually.
Point of recording. I don't know when this is going out on Radio Sega, so...
Theoretically, we'll be going out at the beginning of next month.
Beginning of July.
Voyager, lots of fun there. Gotten past pretty much anything Rocky, I imagine. Closing in on the final now. That's pretty much what I've been watching, other than going through some of the Unus Arnus videos, the old Markiplier and Ethan Nestor stuff.
I thought that channel was deleted.
What's that?
What is that? Yes. Unfortunately, with the internet, you cannot actually delete everything, sadly.
This is true. The Wayback Machine is powerful.
Yeah. There are compilations out there, and it's just every so often it's interesting, because there was so much stuff happened that if you're kind of just sitting around for an evening, you can kind of put on one of those videos and just kind of go, oh, they did that, we should do that. It's kind of interesting. It also is an amazing time capsule for looking back at let's say 2019 and the events that followed that year and how people existed.
Yes.
Those have been that. In terms of games, finished playing up some Minecraft modded Minecraft stuff. That was fun. It's always nice to play some digital Legos every once in a while. Some of the mod people make for that game, it's actually surprising. It's like they make an entirely new game with the base game, and I am never astounded what people can code in that. It's like these are people who, I swear, they could have their own studio to make their own games. The talent that's put in there. Like, there's one mod like Create, which adds trains and conveyor belts and more machinery that's. You get to basically make, it's like, games where it's like a PC builder simulator or any kind of other game like that, or like My Summer Car, where you get to put everything together. Just tickles that particular fun point. But I think there's only really one game that's worth mentioning talking about this month for me, which is the new Zelda game, Tears of the Kingdom.
I didn't even realize you had it, to be honest.
No, I've been playing it sort of on and off on the Switch, because I'm mainly playing it at work, because that's the best place for the Switch to be when you're on a night shift and nothing's going on for a few hours.
Fair.
And that game is big. I feel as though the Breath of the Wild didn't... I was done by this point. But there's three different layers. There's the sky, the land, and the depth. And I feel like I've kind of done about... Not including Korok seeds. Fuck those guys. There's too many of them. But going through... And thinking, like, I think I've done maybe about 70% of the regular world, and like the depth and the sky have been barely touched. This is a game that does astound me that it even exists. But that's the benefit of being like being the first party Nintendo, is like they know how that Switch works. They know how to get every single bit out of that console, which is to say, it doesn't occasionally lag or have some issues. But being able to build things again, like build these massive contraptions. I've built more like Mad Max vehicles in that game than I think any other game I've ever played.
It's weird because like I've looked at it and it looks pretty good, but the building stuff instantly reminds me of Nuts and Bolts.
It's very similar.
Very much Legend of Zelda Nuts and Bolts. Yeah,
it's like if you played Breath of the Wild, or if the system was in Breath of the Wild, it exists more or less identically in Tears of the Kingdom. With the combat feels exactly the same, weapons feel the same, degradations of weapons are the same. But so what they've done in Breath of the Wild, you had the Sheikah Slate, and now you have the Pura Pad instead. The Sheikah Slate was kind of designed to be used in combat as well. So as well as just swinging your sword and bashing away with your shield, you also had like the ability to stop enemies, freeze them, throw bombs at them. The Pura Plate is now pretty much a strictly non-combat device. So you're much more reliant on your actual combat skills. You can't freeze an enemy and then shoot them in the head with a bow for a quick stun.
You can't just spam bombs at them ad infinitum.
No, you can't. So the combat definitely feels more challenging because of that. But I think that's kind of nice. You kind of have like the Pura Pad is kind of designed specifically for the fun of building, fusing weapons together to make extra long stick to poke at enemies 3 miles away.
Yeah, I guess my biggest concern with that is because the weapon degradation stuff is still there. You know, the average combat encounter for Breath of the Wild, I found you had to go through 4 or 5 weapons to kill a small group of enemies. And like killing one of the big mecha things, I can't remember, the Guardians.
Yeah.
You know, that I used an entire legendary weapon just to kill one of them. And it feels like, okay, and now I can't use bomb cheese. Yeah, I feel like it's going to make it
You're not. You're not short of resources. Like, I feel like the idea is that generally you'd go through like one item and you'd get 2 items back from an enemy. Like the idea is the economy does work out. The problem I often find it does still feel occasionally though, like I wish with this fusion thing and with the whole new, so like rather than Guardian tech, it's Zonai tech. It would have been nice if there had been like an item that was just like a hilt that you could just quickly fuse items to, give it a few smacks, and if that breaks, you just refuse a new item to it so that you're never short of a weapon you can just use.
But that's why you can fuse a rock to a stick.
Yeah.
And then suddenly like you've got a hammer.
Yes, yeah. Basically.
But that, the stick, you'll like get 2 hits out of it and it'll break, and it's like, oh, well, I need to find another stick now. Where's a new one?
Give me a stick.
Running around.
I did notice that the weapon degradation does reduce a lot when you do the fusion.
Yes, I think the idea is you keep something fused.
Yeah, like the weapons themselves at base are pretty fragile because everything in the kingdom has become deteriorated. Essentially, all the weapons have worn out, so you need to fuse them to power them up and make them last longer. So the idea is that you're always taking a Bokoblin horn or a Lizardo tail, slapping that on whatever weapon you find, and then just working with that. A couple of things that it's a great game. Degradation is one of the downfalls. The other downfall, though, is it's a mixed blessing. In the original game, when you defeated a boss, you'd get a power up, whether it be the Revali's Gale that launched you up or the Goron Shield, all that stuff. Now you get powers, but they are clunky to use because the way you use them is interacting with the ally you've gained by defeating by doing the temple or the dungeon. So, for example, these are mild spoilers, but by this point, it's a month and a bit after, so...
You'd be surprised. I've not actually gotten to any of the ally parts of the game as yet.
I didn't know.
No.
So you've not done any of the temples or anything?
Nope.
No. I'll keep it as unspoiler as possible, but whenever you beat a temple, you get a sage power, and that sage power is... It gives you an ally, someone like a spirit version of that of the sage who comes around and assists you in combat. And like they actually do assist you in combat. They don't necessarily do a lot of damage, but they are distractions. And if there's like one hit enemies, they can just deal with it. They can protect you. But then, say you want to use the ability one of them gives, you have to run over to them and interact with them. But when you move, they try and go back to a formation. So that's annoying. So sometimes it's like you're in the middle of a fight and it's like, I need that power up. Where's the dude? Oh, he's there, and you're trying to run over to him to get the... And it feels very, just very janky, very clunky. Like I just want this power. I want to get my shield. Give me the shield. And then it's like you might click the wrong dude Or even when you're just picking items up off the ground, if you're like mashing the pickup button, one of them might wander into view and it's like, oh, your items have now been exploded by this dude or whatever. This has happened. And it's, so yeah, like that, the weapon degradation, the fact that the secret, the magical MacGuffin are called the Secret Stone.
Ah.
I don't like that name. Why is it secret?
I've heard worse in other Nintendo games, to be honest.
Yeah.
And the first thing that comes to my head is just Secret Squirrel.
LMC Cast top tip, everybody. Please don't fuse a squirrel to your weapon.
No, but you can to a megaphone.
And you can fuse some frozen meat to your shield.
Yes.
Delicious.
Honestly, the shield surfing is one of the things that's gone way better with that. It's just so much more fun. Like putting wheels on your carts. But yeah. So, I mean, I would say better than the original, but I haven't finished it yet. Like I said, I've put so many hours in and I still haven't. Like, I feel like it's telling me to go to the castle, which is like what the end game was in the last one. So I might be ready. It could be that I go there and then suddenly something else happens and I've still got a whole 50% of the game left. I don't know. Keeping relatively avoiding spoilers. But yeah, I mean, if I've put that many hours into it and I'm actually hitting everything up, I am very happy to do that and carry on.
Good to hear. Good to hear.
Yes, I'd say that's pretty much me.
Yeah, I agree with that assessment in terms of Tears of the Kingdom. I'm enjoying it more than Breath of the Wild from what I've played so far. But it still has all of the drawbacks that I didn't like with Breath of the Wild.
Mm.
And that's kind of what's putting me off even trying it, because Breath of the Wild is definitively now my least favourite Zelda.
Which is odd from someone who likes Dark Souls, the fact that it's kind of lent more towards that direction.
I don't agree, though. I don't feel like it has. The combat is... This is the thing. I like the combat in older Zelda games, and I don't like the combat in the new one because it's just punishing. There's no reason to do combat because it just breaks your weapons.
Yeah, there are times when I just kind of avoid combat. I'm actually also annoyed that I don't know how much of each resource I need. Like, I'm holding on to so many, like, gems. I'm like, I know I need some for this and that, and probably for upgrading my... Oh, that was the other thing that annoyed me. Hey, remember when we talked about how Sonic Frontiers and you like wanted to hand in stuff and you had to go through the upgrade like 1,000 times for each individual thing?
Which I believe they have now fixed.
They have fixed. Same similar thing here. It's like, hey, do you want to turn in your Korok seeds? Cool. Here's a cut. Like, go through the menu. Here's a cutscene. Skip the cutscene. All right. Do you want to do it again? Yeah. All right. Go through the list. Do the thing. Here's a cutscene. Skip the cutscene. Like, I just want to quickly go through. Same with like upgrading your hearts and your stamina. And
I assume it still has to. That's the guy.
He's still dancing. He still does his shaka like a dance.
In which case, it's totally on brand for Hestu to do that.
Yeah,
it is totally on brand for it to be as annoying and frustrating as possible. So I see that more as character than than game limitation.
What about the Great Fairy, though?
No excuse for the Great Fairy.
No. At least when you like, I tend to leave like getting upgrades to health and stamina for as long as possible. So that when I go through, because when you get the first heart piece or stamina bit, it kind of does like a little thing. But then it goes, oh, hey, do you want another one? Yeah, sure. And there you go. Do you want another one? Yes. And there you go. But then if you go back in, it's like, we're going to do the cutscene again. Here you go. Just speed up. But I open up a temple as well. I need to skip the opening of it, then skip the cutscene of going in, skip the cutscene of walking in, and now I can do the thing. It's like, I know it's going for, you know, like immersion, but I've walked into a temple several dozens of times now. I don't need to watch him do it again. I just need to know if I start in it naked or not.
Yeah, sorry, Random Genius, what were you saying?
As I say, I'm enjoying it more than Breath of the Wild. It's not one of the Zelda games I've really fallen in love with, though, from what I've played so far, and that's expected because I wasn't a huge fan of Breath of the Wild. It's not my worst. It's not the worst Zelda game I've played, in my opinion. But I'm still looking forward to seeing what there is to bring with Tears of the Kingdom, and we'll see how things go. So that's I'm cautiously optimistic as to how it is. We will see how it goes.
That's fair.
I'm still waiting to play Breath of the Wild. I've had it for years at this point, and I've not gotten round to playing it. And
so what you're saying is that someone should cash in their points for you.
What I'm saying is that I am slightly worried and kind of have the same worries that I think Earth came across, in that I honestly think when I get to play Breath of the Wild, I'm gonna really struggle in terms of enjoying it. I think I'd really enjoy Tears of the Kingdom just because there is a bit more flexibility. I just get the distinct impression that as soon as I achieve anything in Breath of the Wild, I'm just going to be like slapped down immediately by the game for daring to do so.
The one thing I will say is I did play the Wii U version, and supposedly things like the weapon degradation were much worse in the Wii U version.
So how many other Zelda games have you played, Kev?
How many other Zelda games have I played in general?
Yeah.
A lot.
We all know you played the best Zelda game ever on Steam the other month.
I know.
Damn straight I did.
And finished it.
Yes, I finished it.
Yeah.
And to be fair, like me, both me and Kev have fond memories of what is probably my favourite of the Zelda series.
Wonder Gamelon.
I have never played Wonder Gamelon, believe it or not, because I've never owned the console.
I mean, there's some picky poisons we can try and wrangle.
But then again, I enjoyed Spirit Tracks, which everyone seems to really hate.
I'm surprised by the hate Spirit Tracks guests as well. I much preferred it to Phantom Hourglass.
See, I quite like Phantom Hourglass as well.
Spirit Tracks' first action like, well, Zelda's dead?
Not far off.
I seem to recall that pissed some people off. I don't know. But to answer the previous question, Link to the Past, Link Between Worlds, Wind Waker, Majora's Mask, Ocarina of Time.
Yeah, so pretty much a lot of the main.
A lot of them. I've still got Skyward to do. I've still got Twilight Princess to do. I've still got Breath of the Wild to do as what games I own. Oh, and I also technically own Link's Awakening as well, but that's actually Double Crosses.
Link's Awakening.
It's within reaching vicinity.
I'm sure Double Cross would let you play it.
I think I sort of like co-played it with her. I was the parrot on her shoulder for the various bits.
Cool. Shall we continue the game then?
Yes.